Set just prior to the War for the Crown adventure path. Honor's Echo is a Pathfinder Society adventure, which will introduce our band to the Inner Sea region setting of Tal Dor. Many dangers await our band, both far afield and deep within the political arena.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another exciting episode. Rollmonger's Actual Play Podcast presents Dice Before Dishonor. Tonight, we delve into episode 5 of our prologue series, Honor's Echo. So the party gets to know each other better, learn a couple things about indoor combat. But wait a minute, didn't we promise you a whole bunch of cavaliers and maybe one fly samurai? Didn't we promise you mounted combat? Well, when last left our heroes, they were riding into the, well, not really a sunset, they were riding back into town and deciding on liquidating a lot of the treasure they found and coming up with an extra 50 gold or so each, minus about 5 for expenses for identifying some. I believe you guys came out of the mystery vials with 2 vials of acid, 2 containers of alchemist fire, and 2 tanglefoot bags, as well as 2 pass without trace. So, gold, loot, and gain. Who is carrying what? Because there are 4 of you, and only 2 of each thing. Lay dibs now, gentlemen, because if I happen to push your characters off a cliff, with, of course, where they have the disclaimer, no horses were, you know, hurt during this western, I need to know what gear is in whose backpack.
Well, I was wondering if I can buy a little cart that I can slap onto the back of Barkley.
Cart? You mean like a yoke and harness? Like a little red wagon to pull behind him? A
little bitty wagon, yeah.
Doesn't he hate you enough already? Really? Like, we're going to add more weight?
I thought you already had like a chariot for him.
No, we were talking about that last week, or maybe it was the week before. I was trying to see what the cost would be involved, and then that's what got us looking into how much would it cost to actually hire somebody to
be a porter?
To be like a porter.
Like a camp bitch.
Yeah, no horse. He just runs beside you.
It's more PC. It's 2018, Frank. We can't talk like that.
Not in this game, though. It's whatever the hell year it is. 3760 something?
Yeah.
1478 or something like that?
No. I think Frank is bang on there, actually.
Well, discriminate like it's 1861.
Oh, in that case, slaves for everyone.
Yeah.
So did you actually manage to garner a cost? Now we
I found a cart that the cost of a cart, but I'm just like wondering if I can find that in town type of deal. So then I can throw my stuff in there, and then when we come to a combat, I can just.
Yeah. So this is the advantage of us having Aiden Willems sitting in the wings with us tonight. Say hello, Aiden. Because as he listens to our conversation, we trust that he is immediately Googling and hitting the PDF to bring forth the information for yours truly, GM, to sort of shuffle and, you know, decide upon. So
they already brought it about.
Okay. So what is the cost of a cart? And we just make it small size.
Put a
bumper sticker that advertises animal cruelty on the side.
Not like a wagon, but a cart.
Well, not the animal cruelty that I'm being concerned about.
Two wheels, a little bucket, and like 2 pegs that stick out that tie either side of your saddle.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. According to the PFSRD or Peso site, it's 15 gold for a normal sized cart.
Yeah. So a small one would be like 7.
Okay.
So it's one of your
6.
That's what I'm going to inquire about, and so I'll place my belongings.
Now that's the cart. You still need the rig and to modify your saddle and blah blah. So yep. I'm going to be mean and just go 10.
Okay, so 20 gold?
No, I mean like 10. Like there's 15 for a cart, but since it's small size, it's only like 7 plus the rig, so
okay.
Total of 10.
Sweet. 10.
Miniaturization. Sold. Okay, so take that out of your personal gold. So if I'm correct, you guys had 48 from actual money from the rat folk, then 50 for liquidating their crossbows and all their stuff. Take 5 off for all the expenses of identifying all the extra stuff, and now Matt is down another 10. So you guys literally have like 2 purses full of gold each. Is there any other specific shopping or anything you guys, before the next sort of big thing comes up, before you guys, I don't know, possibly leave town for whatever?
Are we spending the night here?
You guys have actually, we're going to start advancing the timeline a couple of days. You guys are like, you know, you've relaxed, you're paying your meals and everything, that type of thing. You guys
Bartholomew will pay for the relaxing.
Oh, okay. Are we relaxing in style?
Yeah.
Okay.
Nothing but the best for my comrades.
All right.
Okay. I'll go back home to my villa.
We have a rich lord buddy who's like, see you guys. You know, they're paying through the nose for like this shanty little sort of hotelish thing in downtown Opara, overlooking one of those little jazz clubs, you know, where everybody's string goes at the end.
No.
Camera
no.
pans out and there's like the Lord Gildervarge of the state. He just rides north, you know, one of those big...
It's on a hill. You can just see the sun setting behind it.
Oh, you know, I picture the South American villa that they take over in Mercenaries 2, the old Xbox game.
Yeah.
He just rolls in there. That's huge, awesome. White freaking villa castle. Giant, you know, beautiful sunset mountains. Yeah. He goes in there. He's so sad and lonely. He's just servants. His friends stay downtown.
No, I was thinking like dirty bar, we buy a floor of that bar and we own it for a night. Who's in?
Okay.
I think I know just the place.
All right.
I do have some shopping to do before that, though.
Yeah, well, preferably when
there's a reason why I like to be friendly.
Okay. So, trusting that our, you know, accounting between sessions will be caught up and done properly, Bartholomew is making sure we're comfortable, if not in style. Now, is there any major purchases you guys want to pull out of this money before we, you know, get into the next part?
Yes.
Okay. Leo? J. Damlin? Leo,
I would like to sell off the armor that I have because it's rather awkward.
Okay. What do you have?
I have hide armor right now. It's kind of, it's not really awkward so much as like below my station, I guess.
Okay. So what's it worth?
Hide armor is only like worth 15 gold pieces.
Right. So when you sell stuff, you're generally lucky to get half.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't really care how much I get out of it. I just don't want to carry it around.
And what are you buying?
I am buying armor in replacement, although this one is going to be lighter armor. And then I'm going to get a kilt for it as well.
Making it medium and slowing you.
Yeah. Well, I'm already wearing medium armor, but.
Oh, okay. So what are you getting? Don't keep us in suspense.
I'm going to get parade armor.
Oh, excellent choice. For those that don't know, parade armor gives you the same bonuses as something like studded leather. However, it is a stylized uniform that is more fashion than function, but still gives a decent amount of protection. So for the guy that was a man about town, wants to get in parties and that kind of thing without being stripped out of his banded mail, that's actually a very good choice.
And then adding a kilt to it.
Just to be weird. And he just puts a kilt on top of it.
Well, it gives it the same armor bonus as the hide armor, so back up to +4.
Okay.
And it's now medium armor, but it's still parade armor, so.
Yep, and Hero Lab will automatically adjust the extra negatives for your physical skills. Okay, sure. So take that out of your paycheck. Anybody else having a major change in wardrobe or gear that needs to be, you know, would be count-worthy or?
Nah, I already owned a set of parade armor.
Okay, anybody else?
It's the stuff I stroll around town in.
Actually, while we're discussing armor, what does Bartholomew wear? Banded, two parades, and that leaves... Barkley's not armored. Your horses aren't armored. There's no barding yet, right?
Yeah, no barding.
Okay. And Sir Winston's wears what?
He's got scale mail.
Scale mail. Okay. So two mediums, two lights, one modified into a medium. Okay.
Sorry, Shadowless does in fact have barding. It's leather, it's barding.
Oh, and no, that's...
Bartholomew's wearing heavy. He's wearing banded.
Oh, banded counts as heavy armor. Okay. Right. Just so I can have like a video, you know, so the audience can have a visual picture of, you know, how armored up. And I believe Gildervarth, Samish Gildervarth, our lord of the party, is the only guy carrying a shield, correct?
Yeah. He's got field plate or the field armor for when he's in town. And then when he's expecting trouble, he's got scale mail and a quick draw shield that he's got.
You mean you've got parade armor for in town? Because like there's no way you guys can afford field plate.
Yeah, parade armor. That's okay. What I meant. Field plate.
Okay,
and,
so you,
Bartholomew actually has a heavy wooden shield, too.
Okay, so you guys are carrying this extra gear or extra sets of armors, like what, on your horses or on your back?
The extra set of armors on Vicky.
Okay. All right, gentlemen. Drawing your attention after a little rest, relaxation, and shall we say 2 days, maybe 3 tops.
They'll never welcome us back in that town again.
That's the capital. this is not good.
That district.
Oh, you on a road trip? Make the horses
they've
ride
worse there. Don't worry about it.
Takes us on a road trip and rides us across the. What?
No, this is how you travel in style. You go out to a town, you defile your name there. By the way, we all pick names. For myself, I shall pick the name of Lord Gildervarsh.
No, you won't.
You're not there. You're back at your villa.
Damn it!
Identity theft.
What?
Old school identity theft.
Yeah, I was like, what's going on here? All right, gentlemen, coming back the next morning, you know, let's say day or two later, a note arrives to the address you guys have been schlumming in. And since we have sort of Romeo's voice in our heads, trusted associates, Kadira, our fiery neighbor, I need you to travel to its deserts and visit the Ghazali family. They've acquired Haronius' lost sword, an item that's appeared in my research into her life. This is no common blade, but a powerful weapon given to Haronia by the Church of Arodin. Its existence alone might prove the Alcasti's worth. I've included the original record of the sword's transfer to Haronia as a reward for her services to the church and the empire. Show this record to the Ghazali matriarch, Eregida. She will be reasonable. Safe travels, Romero Acosta.
Flair for the dramatic, doesn't he?
Even in penmanship. Opera, the center of the coast in Taldor. Gentlemen, traveling about 180 miles south and to southeast.
Dude, that's like a week.
Yep. To the city of Omash.
Glad I bought the cart.
Which is actually a good about 15, 20 miles past the border. You guys will be leaving Taldor, entering Kadira. Does anyone have knowledge history?
Let me look real quick here.
Now, some might differentiate, but I always took from what I've seen of the actual drawings and stuff as Kadira is something kind of like Persia. If you had Osirian as Egypt and Katapesh as Arabia, Kadira, Persia, what do you guys think?
Yeah, whatever you want it to be.
Well, I'm just going with those cool pointy soldier hats with have the little chainmail coffer on the back of the neck, but
you can make them German for as much as you considered.
Hmm.
That's reasonable. They're also horse lords.
Das ist gut.
Fräulein. What'd you get on that roll?
Fräulein.
Knowledge history, 15.
Okay.
Definitely German.
Couple things about Kadira. They widely, openly, and very long traditionally worship the goddess Sarenrae. They have gone to war with Taldor and each have a standing rivalry of, you know, back and forth as far as politics and kind of like the German and the French going, sorry we invaded you. Oh, it's okay. Sorry we invaded you 20 years again. Okay. You know, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. The off the coast, when you're, shall we say, rich, fertile lands diminish and you go in river, in the Jalrun River, the desert opens up close to the city of Demgazi. And if you travel down the river of Kadira and then back up towards the mountains near White Pass, there is the city of Urfa Halij. And right tucked underneath that word where I've placed is Omash, the city of Omash, which I have a sort of dug up representation behind me. The bright orangish red clay brick make up the buildings. So traveling 180 some odd miles on horseback, a week, two, resting, traveling in style, hitting a whole bunch of cities, or are we just blazing for it, just camping out?
I'd say we would do it at a medium pace.
Okay. Now, you're going to have to like branch off to some place like maybe Zilmar, north of the Borden Wood, to get supplies. You do have to cross the river. Like, the Jarlun River literally, you know, is in your path. There's no up and around it. You could, but by the time you got into the mountains and all the way back through, it would triple your time, so...
Wait. We're in Oprah right now, right?
You are
heading to Omash.
All right. Wouldn't we be able to take a boat
That would be even longer.
Kathir?
Boats travel like 3 to 8 miles per hour. You could, but it would take a lot longer.
Yeah, but they travel 24 hours a day.
That's true.
And we could get down to Kathir and then just zip, zip.
True, but
over to the east.
A very large vessel that can accommodate, feed, and house 4 mounts.
We got the coin.
Isn't easy. Seriously, you guys are like the laziest cavaliers ever. I'm giving you an opportunity to do the wide open ride scene. We're like, let's take a boat.
We'd be like the 4 caballeros.
All right.
In order for us to go to, if we were to take a boat to Kathir, we'd still have to cross the river of Kadira at some point in time.
We could travel around the south tip of it there, head direct hard east.
That's further than us just running straight there.
I believe this river is wide enough to still take that boat like right into the river.
If we were going to get a river, I'd say try to pick up a boat in Demgazi just to cross from there.
That's what I was thinking. Or Zamar. Go to Zamar and get somebody to ferry us across.
This is, by the way, in gameplay talk that we have at the table.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I mean, I'm sure if there's a road and it's a major thoroughfare, there's probably a bridge and we'll just go right over the bridge. Is that too much to ask?
Like this river, is it like the Mississippi, or is it like?
I'm assuming that the dashed lines are
roads.
Are
yes,
roadways, and the blue ones are like riverways.
Yes.
Oh wait, sorry. The red lines are prefecture borders.
Yeah.
And the blues are canals.
So I think we're looking at either getting a ferry from Demgazi or Zamar, or we have to travel to where the road crosses in between Zamar and Lion's Guard.
So that means like above Lion's Guard, the road, this is where your bridge would be.
Yeah.
Right there.
So let's take a vote. Actually, hold on. Let's have the lords get their say in.
Lord.
Oh, well, in that case, yes, I do recommend that we cross on the boat.
Yeah, I mean,
the question is Zamar or Demgazi?
What do we know about either of those towns or cities?
Let's do some knowledge checks, guys.
Mm-hmm.
I've been editing other podcasts all week. Please don't. We don't know much. The DC is incredibly high. So, boat, you say? Right. Right. On the...
All of a sudden.
Skipping all the landmarks. Yeah, shit, what have I done? There's merit in both.
Well, Zamar looks like it might... The dot is darker, so maybe it might be a bigger town.
Probably a bigger town, plus it'll avoid us having to go through the border, always...
Yeah.
So, I vote Zamar.
Sounds good to me.
So I second.
The land route?
Or third.
We're taking the land route?
Yes, we're taking the land route.
Yes, we're taking the land route and going...
You're welcome. Oh...
Oh, no, hey.
Voice from the sky.
Put you on a boat, roll for storms, and, you know, we're all lost at sea. Brand new party, so that's fine.
Have fun trying to charge the Kraken.
Well, shit, ramming speed. I'll time the charge the minute the prow hits the Kraken.
Our lances, ha ha!
Melt that head to the prow of this vessel by the time we're done with it.
I just got this horrible image of, like, Varth, like, on the prow doing the Washington, you know, sword and shield, ramming speed at the Kraken, you know. Bartholomew comes up behind him, like, in Titanic, puts the arms out.
Holding the horse.
I'm flying.
Behold, the largest D20 I could find at our local gaming shop, where I actually had the distinct pleasure of meeting Misty Vander in person from Lady Slaying Dragons, and I bought this gigantic... like size of your fist, D20 to roll, and you know. Then I just went and got new glasses. But anyway,
it's a counter.
Rob's large percentage dice. Ta-da! And gentlemen, you enjoy printed script. A virtual, uneventful trip to Omash. The guards at the city's main gate actually help you find the Ghazali family manor. It is a luxurious estate and lies on the outskirts of Omash itself. Outside the actual fortress city's towering walls, the property has its own sort of mini fortification walls, about 15 feet tall, for its own protection. But it has like a sprawling land manor, so it has more land, you know what I mean, like gardens and stuff that it could actually get inside the city. There is a two-story building that boasts intricately patterned stone floors with rich wall hangings and giant floor-to-ceiling windows. A sandstone wall decorated with geometric mosaics surrounds the opulent Ghazali Manor. Through the brass front gates, white cobblestone paths wind through a garden of flowering cacti and acacia trees to the manor's entrance itself. A pair of guards, clad in polished armor, flanks the heavy wooden doors to the residence.
Sniffing the air kind of in Bartholomew's direction. Okay. We probably should have bathed before coming here.
I fell in the river enough times.
You didn't? I thought that was the horse.
When did you find time for that?
A lord always finds time for best appearances and personal hygiene. Pulls out his chewing stick to clean his teeth.
Yeah, he's immaculate. You guys are all like sweating, rotting mess.
Splashes a little perfume on or cologne. It
really stinks.
You guys are in the desert city of Omash in Kadira. It is hot. in your medium and heavy armor, gentlemen. And your horses need twice as much water, and so do you. But Varf looks great.
I open my parasol. Did you all buy one or just me?
Wait, no? What color is it? It's like a pinky purple.
Well, it's pinky purple, of course.
No, it's obvious, the obvious red and white intersecting like a certain... No?
No.
Nobody
Who
gets that reference?
Who's supposed to take the lead on this one?
The Umbrella Corporation? Nobody?
Mm-mm.
Oh, thank you, Aiden. He's giving me a thumbs up.
Raccoon City.
Yeah, there
I'm
we go.
I'm muted, you know.
Entering so. A Raccoon City. And then Lord Vosh bites you and all hell breaks loose.
Patient zero.
Here we go. Yeah, a nice drooling lady gave me this and then she bit me on the arm. What? All right.
I figured that's just how they greet people here.
How are you today? How?
I mean, this is Kadira.
Yeah, very still hostile towards any Tel'Darians.
Who was supposed to take the lead on this quest?
Varf. I think Aiden was.
Actually, Varf. You can mute back up there, Mr. Rules Lair. Thank you. Put you back on your shelf. Do we need you again? Actually, Lord Varf is our lead on this one.
Right then.
All right. So I'll take out the letter as we approach the gate.
Okay.
Look at it as I'm, you know, just kind of perusing it again quickly. The Ghazali family. Let's ask these gentlemen here if they can direct us. I'd hate to wander about this city aimlessly.
Okay. The guards move to intercept you, look at your documents, nod. They summon servants to look after your mounts, who steadfastly refuse to go with strangers.
Oh, go, Vicky. It'll be fine. They'll have water and food and shade and comfort. It'll be fine. Vicky, the oddly intelligent horse, nods.
All right.
Trots off.
Gentlemen, you guys all encourage your mounts to cooperate.
Sir Winston offers his services.
No, never mind that. I can take care of this with the porters.
So you're going to take Barkley personally around the side to the stables?
I'll take Barkley and aid in getting everybody else's creatures. Barkley, shut up.
Okay. Okay. Winston, this doesn't present a problem until you try to bring a large wolf into a Kadiran stable with Kadiran horses who smell the wolf and are not happy about it. The groommaster comes from out back.
What is all this fuss? And what is that beast doing in my stable?
Glaring down at Portly, assuming the halfling is a servant, striding a wolf, and leading three horses.
Oh, you'll watch your tone with me.
I assume you serve the lords. We have been told to look after it, and the horses.
I serve no one but my own conviction.
I'm sorry. My Tal'Dorei tongue is not so good. Please wait here for interpreter.
And he just leaves you out there in the sun, goes back to work inside.
We'll take Barkley outside and tie him out of the stable and make sure everybody else's horses get situated. And then I'll find a shady place to lounge with Barkley.
All right.
Have a good snooze. Bring him, you know, bring a bowl of water, all that fun stuff.
Yeah.
Maybe that extra one to sponge between my rolls.
Yeah, no, hey, way to stay in character, man.
Let the other cut rations and throw them at Barkley.
He's just plucking things out of the garden randomly. Eat the cactus and stuff. Ooh, Barkley ends up with, like, you know, Technicolor high vision.
Barkley hunts for his food.
Oh, really? Sweet. So, getting back to the main interior. Gentlemen, Leon, Bartholomew, and Lord Samish Gildervarth. A domed ceiling of this grand room soars above with red and white tiles whose patterns resemble roses in bloom. Between the mahogany bookshelves that line the chamber itself, suits of armor stand at attention, and an empty rack faces the doorway we entered. The guards motion for you to please wait here, and a power struggle, yet polite for society, time elapses.
I will have kind of made myself comfortable.
Yep. Servants bring refreshments.
I pull a couple of books off. They're mahogany libraries?
There's mahogany shelving.
And what's on the shelving?
Books and knickknacks, you know, that kind of thing. Things that suit right. Kadirian.
I pull a couple of books off.
Okay.
Read them.
They
attempt
are
to.
Written in the native tongue. Can you read it?
I make like I can.
Okay. He's doing the...
He stares at the squiggly lines on the pages, nodding.
Thumb and index fingering down his chin.
Deep. Next.
Okay. Lord Varth, he's got a copy of something called Karma and Sutra in his hands, and it's obviously upside down.
Who am I? You might want to set that one aside for now. It will be less than useful in this given circumstance.
Wait, there's a fold-out page.
You don't know that.
Guards re-enter stamping their feet in unison and tapping their spears on the tiled floor, announcing the arrival of your host, Lady Aragia El Fakira Ghazali, is a middle-aged Kalashite woman. She comes and sits alone, no husband, and greets you. But you can tell the pleasantries are falling flat. She's very distracted, and she seems somewhat, obviously, distraught.
Seeing that she's distraught, I'll kind of set the, you know, wine or whatever I was drinking off to the floor to the side and stand up, you know, clutch my pearls, as it were. Lady Gazira,
you wear pearls?
Well, yeah. I mean, doesn't all nobles wear some minor trinkets and jewelry? And
sorry, I just, I guess.
Handkerchief tucked in there. No, I'm not like an 1800s old lady.
I'm just sorry.
I've got the vapors from the heat. No, no.
Oh my God, that was so good.
just kind of hold my
hand. Oh, it's my
a better
God.
Southern woman than I could ever do.
I know. It's
I greatly appreciate
it. It's Mrs. Doubtfire Varth.
Hello.
Good
heavens, no.
Would you any of you guys like to make a perception or sense motive at this time while I collect myself?
I would love to make a sense.
Yes, please.
Okay. Pop them up, call them out, and then we will continue with the awesome, awesome role-playing.
14, sense motive.
Round of sense motives. Anyone else? No?
Sense motives of 6, so I'm distracted.
Oh, okay. Bartholomew, you're still into your book? Or are you...
Actually.
Perception of 24. I hid that book, and it's in my jerkin.
Can I use a trait that I have?
Sure, what's that?
It is... Or, sorry, it's the feet, actually.
Go ahead.
Because I'm connected to the
Vinmark
family, I'm allowed to make once a day. I can re-roll a sense motive check.
Sure,
nice.
Do you want to do that now?
I do.
That. Okay, go right ahead. And if you want to tuck that away without anybody seeing, because the guards are eyeballing you,
don't even try to make it discreet.
So you don't even bother the sleight of hand. You just whoop. That's mine.
No. Like the Lordess has come in. It's like, oh, all right. She's the center of attention. Book in the vest. I'll read this one later.
Okay, give me a bluff check as you sort of capitalize on the distraction.
All right, bluff check of 16.
You're going to jail.
If anyone has noticed, no one seems to call you on it at the moment. And re-rolling the sense motive, Mr. Vinmark.
Sense motive of 15.
Okay, and any other perception checks while we're in the mix?
Perception check of 24.
Okay, and Frank and Leo?
My perception check was 14.
Okay. And mine was 12.
Okay. Starting with a description that I usually tend to do, gentlemen, on the bottom. So usually the first thing I do would be the lower rolls. Then adding a tasty bit of information would be the medium rolls. And then pointing out someone like, you know, that broke over 20 for the really juicy tidbit. So the woman obviously is used to wealth, but is comfortable enough that her emotions, she doesn't really care about propriety at the moment. Something is obviously really upset this woman. That much is obvious. And the perception's over 15, gentlemen. You can see that her eyes are rather bloodshot, like she's been crying all night or as high as a kite. Bartholomew, with your masterful perception check, no hookah stains on the fingers, no baggy, you know, like no extra effects showing that she actually is on drugs or whatever. So the woman has probably been crying her eyes out. You do notice that she does have the wedding band, like the Kadira symbol of I am married, but no husband forthcoming at the moment. And sensing motive, she just, you can also tend, like, it's not polite in this society for them to just like come in, be upset, and then tell you their problems going, oh, excuse me, I'm upset and this is why, like it is a normal society. You guys sense that as gentlemen, you're supposed to like ask comfort and then draw out that information before they are technically allowed to give it. Back to Gildevarth and his pearls.
All right. So,
clutched
ever so tightly. I, you know, make my way across the distance between the two of us where she sits and offer up a lightly scented handkerchief that I had. Please dry your eyes. It bothers me to see you upset. So is there anything that either I or my companions can do for you?
Oh, no. Forgive me. Thank you. You are so kind.
She says, dabbing.
I have looked over your documents and I believe that what you say is perfectly legal and my household is willing to trade, but it is my son. If he has gone missing, he has big dreams, you see. He
begged us to be allowed to train at one of the war academies in the city, but I could not bear the thought. I'm afraid that he has run off to slay some sort of more imaginary dragons and found himself a real one. And he has... And she points to like a bare spot on one of the shelves where there's these two little stands. They're not very tall. They only need to like be an inch to like prop up a sword. But being that sort of 3 to 4 foot distance apart and nothing else on the shelf between them, obviously that's where the sword was displayed. And she, quivering hands apologetically almost, is like, and I believe she's taken the sword with him. I'm so sorry.
Well, it's not like a young man to shy away from stretching his legs from time to time. I wouldn't fear that the worst has come to him. It would be my honor if I could help you locate your son.
Yes. Yes, please, thank you. The desert is a very dangerous place outside the city gates. Even at night, the city itself is filled with... Well, I will tell you one thing. I will gladly give you the sword if you bring my son home. Otherwise, I cannot give it to you even if I wanted to.
Yes, yes. Were there any places he was talking about visiting? Any things of interest that had captured his attention?
No, no. I know my son must have it. He always spoke of using it in the family's name and, as I said, begged to be trained before he, you know, would ever go afield, but it feels something has got into him. This morning I woke and found him gone and the sword is missing. He barely knows how to use it. It was supposed to go to my eldest daughter.
And where is she? Perhaps she may know where this young hero in training may have gone off to. Or the quartermaster... He would be another one to question. This young man would need a mount, would he not?
My daughter is, well, I believe she feels responsible and guilty, but at the moment, just to be sure, she is searching the city. I dare not lose two of my children. I have forbid her to leave the city grounds. So just in case we are wrong, she is scouring the city, looking for Aif.
Well, let's have a talk with this quartermaster, stable master of yours. If he left the city, he'd definitely need mount and provisions.
No, spoken with all the guards in my household and the servants. None saw him leave. He must have left before the break of dawn. And Aif is clever enough not to bother them and leave a trail. He most likely had planned this and snuck off the ground somehow without anyone seeing him. All the servants are loyal to me. I have already spoken with them. None, sadly, have saw him depart or were in cahoots, as you would say in Teldor.
Pardon me, my lady, but your son, does he ever frequent a tavern?
First, her eyes go up, up, up the gully green giant. Looks questioningly at Samish as if, you know, forgive me, but again, she assumes you're a servant. Half-orcs and halflings tend to be cast in that, and, you know, standing even in the company of the brilliance that is Lord Gildervarth. She's not offended that you're speaking, but she is sort of looking to Varth to verify the question.
I'll look to him and go, that's a good point. Has he been known to frequent any watering holes of the common people? I mean, where would he get these stories of adventure?
No, my son is not interested in slumming it. He wishes to be a hero, to set himself apart with the family name. I mean, even the city guards, she shakes her head in frustration, they refuse to help me, because Aif is, in our culture, old enough to be considered a man, his own man. But he is my only son. I beg of you, please.
Well, point us in the right direction to who we can talk to. Perhaps they may be more willing to talk to foreigners than... his own mother.
Samish. I give Samish a nod. I'll be back. I just kind of depart.
So while Samish continues to sort of walk the lady through her mourning, who does he talk to? Who could we talk to? You know, where can we start besides tossing the kid's bedroom? The scene actually follows Bartholomew for a moment. Leon, are you staying with Samish or going with Bartholomew?
The lady seems rather to be in the process of being consoled, and... at that point in time, I think Gildervarth might have more luck on his own, like one-on-one. So I'm going to exant stage left with Bartholomew.
Okay.
So I want to head out. So this building is more of it's a compound that has its own guard structure.
It's a manor, two stories, manor, and has its own walled perimeter.
There's guards, right?
Yes.
All right. I tracked down the first guard.
Outside the front door, you know there were two.
All right. guard on the right.
Now, you want the guys that are, like, outside this door? The man over here talking?
You're not,
like,
that's too close.
Right, you're saying outside the building, right? So outside the building, there's the two guys at the front door let you in and led you to this room.
Yeah, those guys.
Okay.
Hey.
Sup, Teldorian?
Sun's hot.
Fold their arms, you know, side on a 45-degree angle.
Sun is hot today.
They just kind of narrow your eyes at you like you're making some kind of bad culture joke.
No, literally. The sun is hotter here. I don't know how you Quadrians deal with it.
He snorts diversely at you, but puffs out his chest in pride, like, yeah, that's right, we can take it.
The boy of this house, the one who took off chasing dragons.
They nod.
Where did he spend his times?
Did your lord send you to interrogate us?
No, I came here to ask you, and I flick a coin over at him.
Okay, deftly catches it, like the hand just snaps out like he was expecting the bribe, and it tucks it away in a flash.
For when you're off duty. You nods. Should be thirsty.
Nods in and, like, does the two-finger wave over and leans in.
Ayef is a good boy. He technically is old enough to wield a sword, so the city guard does nothing.
He says,
but we did search the grounds. We did not find much, but we're not skilled at such things. We're not trackers, and the boy is, how shall we say, a little full of himself. He did not interact with us directly so much.
No, but surely he spilled ale somewhere.
I don't know what it's like for you in Taldor, Half-Orc, but this family is quite wealthy. Women, wine, song, all come here to party. The nobles and their sons, no need to go out.
That's half the fun is going out.
It's more fun to show off what you have, huh?
That's a debate for later tonight, my friend.
Well, I'm the second NPC to tell you that the tavern is kind of a dead end, but you can do as you wish.
But speaking of what you have, has he ever mentioned any potential stories of grandeur? Where would one go to become a hero?
Straight into the mountainous desert, I would suppose, if he's looking to slay something dangerous, directly southeast.
Oh, what's southeast?
The desert and mountains. Well,
Yes, I'd imagine that, but what kind of beasts would one go out to look for?
Oh, well, wild animals, slavers, bandits lurk out in the desert. You don't think any of those caught him, do you?
Well, if he went in the desert, that would be a possibility, but let's hope not.
I've never heard of any mountainous dragons in the region outside of Omash, if that's what you're getting.
Oh no, I didn't think there would be either.
Our young lord is, how shall we say, at an impressionable age.
The other one's nodding like, yeah, he's got it, yeah.
You go looking for trouble, he'll find it.
Your young lord, he enjoyed life well?
He's a good boy.
That's not what I asked.
Well, reaching over to Bartholomew, I say quickly to the guards, well, we hope to keep him that way. If you come with me, Bartholomew, I think we need to have a bit of a chat with Winston.
That sounds fair enough. He should be over by the stables still.
Okay. You guys head over to the stables?
Mm-hmm.
And pick up. There's a wolf curled up in the shave, chewing on some jerky, and Winston just, you know, doff some armor and just curled up, having a lovely nap. Where he actually got the hayseed sticking out of his mouth, you have no idea in the middle of the desert, but, you know, it's crucial for napping.
Yeah, just wearing the, you know, like the Under Armour.
Yeah, the padded t-shirt kind of thing, you know. Just
sitting there with my helmet down over my face to shade, you know, and,
there you go.
And legs crossed.
Sweat stain, snoring, sweat stain.
He's got like his heel boots up on the side of Barkley. And
Winston.
Not today, mother.
I look over to Leon, and it's just that silent moment shared.
But Winston, you're going to be late.
As Leon plays a little bit and Bartholomew just bites his thumb to not laugh out loud.
Kind of gets up, stretches, drops the helmet off of his head, looks around. Oh, is it time for lunch? And slowly kind of, you know, does the overly large person take forever to stand up?
Yeah.
Oh, excellent. Could you please have Barkley check around for any scents?
Scents for what?
Yes, you've missed quite a bit. There was a young lord who escaped, who ran away from the establishment.
He's escaped from this lavish mansion with women and wine. Bastards.
We consider that escape, Leon.
So happy
I'm
you
sure
got it.
Consider it elation.
Right then, I need an article, something with his scent. Worn clothing, a hairbrush.
I'm sure that can be arranged.
Piece of
Bartholomew, do you think you could keep Sir Winston here occupied?
I'm sure this can be arranged easily.
I gotta put my armor on. It'll take me some time.
Okay. So,
hey, Winston, look at this.
Half an eaten sandwich. Hey,
book that I was looking at that has the fold-outs.
Oh. So, Leon, I take it you're going to scoot back inside and, you know, politely ask for a personal belonging, you know?
Yes.
Go rip off the bed sheets or something?
Yep.
Okay.
I figured that me asking would be better than the half-orc asking.
Sure. Okay, so coming back inside, let's get back to Samish. While you guys are outside, Lord Gildavarth, walking Our Lady through the morning and everything. She tells you a little bit more about the boy and some habits that could possibly give you some insight later into the adventure. We'll get into it right now. And shortly, Leon comes popping through the door again, asking, cue the samurai.
I hate to interrupt.
Oh, behave, Lee. Oh, yes, yes. No, you weren't interrupting.
Would it be possible for us to find an article or something that the boy wore recently? We have one of our compatriots is quite skilled at tracking, although generally by scent.
Varth and the lady are sitting side by side, leg crossed, going through like a scrapbook of the boys, just having, you know, tea time and a great time. Varth's so smooth.
Tea time.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, yes, lady. That's your son sitting on a log there. It's quite touching, touching.
She summons a guard, and I think she's getting the idea, and asks one of the servants to go fetch the boys' laundry. That hasn't been done yet. You know, something that's obviously got the boy's scent on it or whatever, you know, handkerchief.
His beard comb.
His other favorite, his second favorite hairs around the house, you know, that kind of thing.
Actually, while we're waiting, might we be able to go examine the boy's room?
If you think it'll help.
There might be something he left.
Okay. Both the lady and a guard stand in the doorway and watch you, but you guys are, the two of you are free to, like, poke around the boy's room. It's been gone over, obviously made up by servants. And as the lady said, they had already looked for clues, as it were. However, if you guys wish to make perception checks or take the proverbial 10 or 20, feel free.
Flip the mattress.
What are you expecting to find? The Kama Sutra is like open for guests in the living room. There's no Kadira.
Ladies of
Kadira under the mattress, dude. Bartholomew just constantly looking. I don't know what's wrong with you, man.
No. You go to flip the mattress and the whole bed just it's all attached.
Taking 20 is like 2 minutes kind of thing, right?
Per 5 foot square, but yeah.
Okay.
Take your time, because I'm going to need some time to scent out the grounds anyway, so someone can get the laundry to me.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, there's no reason why a couple of us can't take 20s and just kind of comb over the room real quick.
Sure. Yeah, like, you know, tracking time, you know.
So that's what we'll do.
10-20 minutes later, nothing seems out of place. The boy doesn't have anything, like, really incriminating, like a journal that could be like, you know, I finally made preparations for my big quest to these coordinates, you know, but it's a secret, but I'll write the coordinates down in my journal. No, sorry, guys, you're just not getting any of that kind of stuff. However, being thorough and covering all your bases, still kudos, is good player 101. So I do tip my hat to you. However, gentlemen, the room seems very nice and opulent, but does not seem to have any sort of tip of a hat of something he was whittling. Now, there are a private collection of war stories. The kid obviously idolizes, like, heroes. There are books on war, and there's books on warcraft, and, you know, swordplay and stuff like that, and a history of Kadira that are focuses on heroes, their version of it, you know, that kind of thing. But other than that,
go ahead.
I was going to say, is there like a common theme to the books on heroes? Like, are they all doing anything? Do they run out into the desert or?
Oh, they're not all like specifically swordsmen or whatever. They're all people that like Sinbad kind of tales, you know, traveled, guy traveled afar, left an awesome mark everywhere he went. You know what I mean?
So in none of those books, there's a relatively close battle or, you know, historical event.
Ah, well, actually, come to think of it, there is something that does stand out. There are not just heroes like martial heroes, but there's also some, like, they take Saren right here very, very seriously. So famous clerics and, you know, your crusading types, right?
Right, right.
There's also mention of, like, shrines and temples and such.
Go on, I'm sensing something here. Are there any nearby old temples?
He's actually marked down locations inside and outside the city, even if some that are like nothing but ruins anymore.
Any of them close by, say within a day's travel?
Yes. Why? Towards the mountains, no less.
I hold the book up that's got these marked.
Okay.
I think we may have something here.
All right. Holding it out, the guard comes over and nods and translates. you know, symbols of Sarenrae, little hutched, you know, markings, little house type that are obviously marked like for temple and whole, you know, this kind of generic map cartography anyone can read. And this, anyway, he confirms your suspicions. The boy seemed interested in historic sites. Now, just not just the temples and shrines, there's also battles, even ones against Taldor, you know. The ones that are winning, he's like, rip them out. Where Taldor's winning. The ones where Caldera wins, he's like, you know, highlighted them and shit.
Right on. Well, let's see here. I'll go find the lady of the house again.
Oh, she's right there in the doorway. Like I said, they, you know, all right. they let you turn over the room, but they're kind of standing there curious, or, you know, making sure you're not.
And it turned to look at her and, Lady Ghazali, we may need water and provisions. It looks like we have a location.
Well, you work out the details. Has the servant returned with the clothing yet?
Yes.
You know? Okay, and then I will take that if that's okay with you. And, yep. Well, my friend here explains what we're planning. I will be taking this out to my compatriot.
Yeah, I can even say that Leon did slip out. Like, you guys tossed the room, and then Varth came interested in the specific books and started looking through them and taking minutes to find some kind of connection. And
I helped.
Yeah.
you did the lion's share of it. I'll grant you credit where credit's due.
Okay, I was just fast-tracking you to what you want to do, and now you're backtracking yourself going, oh, but I was still there helping. Well, make up your mind, man.
Again, I would take the item and go out.
Oh, okay, off you go.
Yes.
Okay, so, waving the kids' jammies proudly, Bartholomew, Leon returns.
By this point, I'm on, like, the 8th fold-out with Winston, and then it goes down over here.
Winston is like... He's got his, like, top of his armor on, but not the pants. And both him and Barkley are, like, leaning in with their heads cocked looking at this book. Barkley's just shaking his head, and Winston's like, how is this possible?
I don't get it. This is like a Quadrian puzzle or something.
Leon, you see them approach. They all look very puzzled, and then they turn the book, like, 90 degrees, and then they all kind of, like, nod. Oh, yeah. Okay, there it is. Oh, we get it. There you go. Okay. Oh, yeah. Anyway.
Oh, my.
Leon, glad to see you. Come, look at this.
It's honestly not as fun as it looks. Anyways, and he passes the item to Winston.
Winston quickly finishes buckling his britches.
Okay.
Yeah. Grab the bag of laundry, hold it up to Barkley so he can get a good sniff.
Okay.
And have him find the freshest tracks. I did a bit of reading, and scent DC is base of 10 plus 2 for every hour.
Okay. So
the track
give me a survival check on Barkley's behalf, and you get a plus 4 for having the scent ability.
Plus, yeah, which is actually, it's the same as mine, so I could probably just roll mine on that, couldn't I?
Well, you could, one could aid another.
Oh, sweet.
How about you aid Barkley, and then, because not only have you guys already stated story-wise he's the lead, you on all fours helping him smell would just be freaking hilarious. I will help you, Barkley.
Might speed up the process a bit, too.
No.
That's not a track.
Sorry. Helping him do, not necessarily doing the same thing.
All right, that's mine. I got a 15 with Winston, and okay. I need a D20 plus 4. And a 9 with Barkley.
Okay, so 9 with Barkley, and your plus 2 is like 11?
That's plus 4 if I'm aiding because of my helpful trait being a halfling.
Okay, so 14. All right. So we circle the grounds, like you're doing like a once around, or are you, like, what are we, just kind of wandering around the grounds, or what are we doing here?
Wait, here. Survival? I think I can aid with that. Yeah, I can.
Yeah,
then okay. Aid with it. If you've got
I will it, aid.
Aid away, and I would say we'd start at the gate.
Okay.
14.
So you're doing the perimeter and then working your way back in?
Yeah.
To ground zero, which would be like his bedroom?
Right.
Okay. What did you get for aid another? 8?
I got a 14.
Oh, you got a 14. Okay, so another plus 2 brings you up to 16. Okay, so picture this. We start at the gate, and he gets a good scent, and he's going along there, and you do like one quarter of the grounds. And now we've got, and like, you know, Barkley's like shaking his head no. And then Winston gets down all four, and the two of them are like doing the second part of the ground, and they're both looking at each other, shaking their head no. And they're going, they're on the third part, and they're working their way around. And then, you know, Bartholomew joins in, and the two of them go right past this like gap. There's like a hole in the wall. And Bartholomew, you find like a little scrap of cloth that's been caught on the gap in the low wall. It's fluttering in the wind. The two of them were so intent on this, you know, the scent.
The whole time why I didn't help him in the first place is because I was busy trying to fold everything back up into the book.
Mm. You guys do notice, though, there are no tracks. There's, besides the cloth, which now Barkley, you know, you guys lead him to it, and Barkley like nods, yeah, that's his. The boy must have covered his tracks. And the only thing that betrays him, besides the obviously escape route of the small hole in the wall, is a torn piece of fabric. But the three of you together beating the Excellent. DC 15 of 15 DC check of with a 16, there's a bright piece of fabric sticking out of the sand near the hole in the wall.
See, which direction is this hole facing? Southeast?
But of course.
Leon, if you do me the favor, please go grab Gildivars.
If you're suggesting what I think you're suggesting, we are one step ahead of you. We should meet him in the front of the front of the facility.
Foyer.
Thank you.
Don't forget the horses.
Yes.
Winston will ride Barkley back to the stable and have the hands ready the mounts.
All right. By this time, I would have, you know, kind of gathered up, you know, whatever supplies that Lady Ghazali is willing to offer up, you know, whether it's water or, you know, even a decent map.
Do any of you guys speak Kelishite?
I do not speak Kelishite.
Anyone?
I'm going on a limb and I'm going to probably say no.
Okay.
How many languages do you want me to know, man?
Oh, your neighboring country might, I don't know. Anyway.
What language?
He's from Zaitan. Katapesh. The Kelishite language or whatever it's called.
Oh, I speak Kelish.
Kelish?
Yeah.
Okay. Lord Varth.
I speak Jive.
You come out front and they are getting your horses and meeting us at the gate. Is that right?
That's our plan, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So you guys mount up and you're riding out, okay? And in low tones, you catch two of the guards making sort of gossipy gestures and comments about your horses.
Why do they got to do that?
Oh?
I don't catch it at all. Sorry, Gildivars, all you.
So what do I hear them say?
Well, basically, they're talking about how great Taladian horses are, but they seem to be sarcastic. Nothing's faster than a Taladian horse. Snicker, snicker. Nothing's better than a Taladian horse. Snicker, snicker. You know. Do you guys have any, actually, intelligence check with plus your level in Cavalier, or a knowledge history, or knowledge local? That all work. I'd even go so far as knowledge nobility, because the nobles here are also very proud about something.
Knowledge local, 21.
Okay. Kelishite horses are very, very, very proudly bred. They are fast. They are, you know, it's like 13th Warrior. You have the sleek, fast Arabian horse that jumps over the great big wars. You know what I mean? These guys are very, very, very proud of the horses. So as a sarcastic remark, merchants, nobles, everybody has this sort of cutting jive remarks about Taladian horses, but it's in reverse. So you say, oh, you know, no problem. It's fast as a Taladian horse, but it's basically saying, you know, it's slow as hell.
Mm-hmm.
That type of thing. Taladian horses are actually the butt of a lot of sarcastic Kalashite sayings because they are so proud about their own horses. And you guys just brought three Taladian mounts of varying range and size. So it's only a matter of time before, like, you know, you know, that kind of thing.
Have we? As far as I know, my mount is the only one that's actually a Taladin charger. As far as I think the rest of them are just standard horses.
Yeah, true. But none of them are Kalashite horses. So yeah, they're just lumping them in.
Yeah, fair enough.
But fair
point. They're being horses.
Horsist instead of racist.
Yeah. One mutt horse looks like the rest, in their opinion.
You know, it's the 37th century. We can't talk like this anymore, guys.
Their neighing all sounds the same to me.
All right. So, heading outside, guys. You guys want to do what?
Charge off into the distance.
Southeast.
Towards the southeast, yeah. Do any temples...
Pick up any tracks and maybe...
Yep. Can I have survival checks outside the wall then, gentlemen?
Yep.
Do any temples or ruins align with this southerly exit through the wall?
Can I have an intelligence check?
Okay.
I'm sorry, did you ask to take the book with you?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
That's why I said any water or maps of the area or anything.
Oh, okay.
Like that.
Sorry. So yes, the boys book is like a reference. Then yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And I'll hold it up. We may be looking to go here first.
Now, the hole is on the east side. But survival? Gentlemen?
Survival check of 24.
The tracks do start veering. Like they remember how I said the manor is outside the city? They almost immediately veer off to the southeast. And the boy doesn't seem to have bothered, you know, it was like, cover my tracks inside the grounds, because he seemed to know that they were going to search for him in there. But he did like a little, you know, 10, 15 feet outside the wall and then just kind of bolted. And then the tracks become relevant. Easy to find, DC of 10, straight out in the southeast.
Perfect.
And as far using Varth as our compass, going, yep, that's the, you know, looking at his book like a compass, and you guys actually following the tracks, it is not long before we ride for the day, and the sun is just beginning to set on the sun-scoured runes, a remnants of a campfire along a low wall with several higher disheveled, destroyed, and sort of a 10-foot gap, a 15-foot wall, a 5-foot piece of rubble. There is no real structure here, just jutting random what's left of walls spread out in like a 50-foot area, which standing out of the desert after a day's ride, tracking the boy and using a reference mark, leads us straight to a chunk of twisted deadwood rests atop a pile of ashes, the lee of a fallen stone column. Cinders surrounding the driftwood do suggest a recent fire. The sand blows across what feels like hard, heavy stonework beneath your feet. What do we do?
I point towards the lee of the stone. It may have made camp there. Perhaps Barclay should go take a look. Or sniff, as the case may be. You know, as I say, as I kind of shield my eyes under my parasol.
We'll roll up to that location. I'll get off and unhook the cart.
All right.
Have Barclay sniff around and also look for tracks myself.
Here, gentlemen, the top of the map. The long black blotches are actually walls that they've decided to sort of just make shadow. Okay. But if you can see the intricate patterns of large 5-10 foot blocks of stonework beneath your feet amongst the ripples of sand, yes, the tracks definitely lead here. The tracks he has alone, and they're all over the area. Like he's, you know, hung out here for like probably the afternoon or something. Decided to like get here as fast as he can, then sit and make a fire and set himself up for a night or whatever, and then kind of, you know, eat something, cook something.
There was a mighty duel here.
Yes.
So how much time do I think has passed from the time he was missing in the morning till right now? I'm trying to figure out how much of a head start he's got.
Sun setting in the desert because it's open. It's probably late. So I'd have to say it's like 7 or 8 p.m. And he got up at first light and you guys hit the place at like, you know, 10, 11 o'clock. You know, that good morning, polite hi kind of thing. They've been crying and searching for like 4 hours. So luckily on horses, you guys like have caught up to him easily enough. He should be here if you calculate.
Should be here. Yeah. Okay.
Because he was on foot, right? Does anyone want to, you know, do you guys want to search around? Like, he's looking for survival as far as tracks, but you guys actually want to, like, spread out, search the area or anything like, you know, perception, that kind of thing?
Sure.
I'll cut wide.
Perception all around, gentlemen.
15 for me.
Okay.
10 for me.
Oh, that soul rolled off the 20. 10.
Leon?
14 for me.
14 for you. Okay. 15 perception. Winston, you find a pack mostly buried in the sand over by the wall here.
Excellent. Is there any food in it?
You begin digging in. As you guys fan out and look around, you hear someone crying out in pain and shouting, "Stay back, Saren Ray! Protect me!" Peering around the wall, gentlemen, you see in the alcove of what is a 20 to 30 foot circular dais amongst pillars, good 30 or 40 feet beyond the walls you guys have been searching, you see a small figure crouched near and what looks to be a 10-foot long stone altar and a gigantic 16-foot long scorpion has him cornered and obviously wounded, and we'll see you next time.
No.
I'm sure this can be arranged easily.
I gotta put my armor on. It'll take me some time.
Okay. So,
hey, Winston, look at this.
Half an eaten sandwich. Hey,
man. Book that I was looking at that has the fold-outs.
Oh, see, I had a really good sandwich joke. All right, no time.
Wrong game.
I'm sure you'll get a chance for that at some point in time.
Oh, you have no idea. You have no idea. After all the sandwich jokes we made in Star Wars, a year later. Anyway, we'll get into it.
Can we not talk about food? I am starving right now.
Get back on your shelf, lawyer. Go eat something, man. It's fading away. It's bloody college students that live on noodles and just, you know, game.
We don't need you right now. Go.
I'll be fine. I just need you to look shit up. Doesn't mean, you know. Anyway.